Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to this press conference. I'm Anthony Rowley, the first vice president of the club, and it's my pleasure to welcome our guest today on my right, Mr. Jun Okumura, who's a long-time official of the Ministry of Economy, Trade and Industry, or METI as it is now, MITI as it was before when he joined it. Mr. Okumura was, among many other things during his time with METI, head negotiator in trade and services for the GATT Uruguay round. He was economic and technological cooperation chief, I suppose, at METI for a long time, and was also head of the JETRO office in New York. He's here today to talk about the US-Japan economic dialogue. US Vice President Mike Pence is due to arrive tomorrow, making his debut in Asia. And he and Deputy Prime Minister and Finance Minister Taro Aso will be carrying on this dialogue. Whether it is a dialogue or a monologue, as sometimes these things have been in the past when the US has sought to dictate terms to Japan, I don't know, but let's at least hope that it won't be a dialogue of the deaf. From what I gather from speaking briefly to Mr. Okumura, it's a rather ad hoc affair. We don't quite know yet exactly what they're going to talk about. They're going to talk about trade issues, certainly, investment issues, possibly monetary issues. And they may or may not be joined by the US Commerce Secretary, Wilbur Ross. So that's all I'm going to say at the moment. I'll hand over the floor to our speaker. So please join me in welcoming our speaker for today.
Well, thank you for that kind introduction. My first thought when I was contacted was, why me? And then I realized that, I am a former MITI official, which is kind of appropriate for this subject. And also, I can do Q&A in English without an interpreter, which is very convenient. But he kindly, perhaps, omitted something that I had written in my personal description, and it will show that. I'll just read it. After 30 years in its ecosystem, the MITI ecosystem, though, it dawned on him that he had no aptitude whatsoever for administration and or management. Armed with this epiphany, he went to the authorities, the people who handle personnel decisions in MITI, and arranged an amicable separation. So if you're here to get some inside information on the dialogue, then even in this heavily MITI-dominated Abe administration, you will be sorely disappointed. But hopefully my experience will help me shed some light on what this visit means. I will talk about, one of the things is that I was in an eight-person room with eight seats over there, and I thought, this, okay, seven people coming to hear me talk. That probably is a good reflection on how much attention this dialogue is getting in Japan, because on Friday I had a chance to talk to a former CEO, first section. Tokyo Stock Exchange. He's retired now, but he's an avid private investor and reads the news. He subscribes to Nikkei, he subscribes to Yomiuri, and he watches television assiduously because he's retired. And I told him that I would be giving a talk on this dialogue, Vice President Pence is coming, and he said, "What?" And he had no idea this was happening. And if you read the Japanese newspapers, you really have to be careful to not to miss the articles on the dialogue. It's never on the front page, unlike the what I call the TPP 11, which is what Abe is finally coming on board for. I'll explain why I'll give my own interpretation what that means, and then I will talk about what is going to happen in this first session of this dialogue, and what is the parties, the governments, and vested interests want out of this these negotiations, and what is likely to, what I think is kind of likely to happen, and I will try to tie that into what appears to be a move by Prime Minister Abe to start the the TPP 11 bandwagon rolling, which I assure you got a lot more attention, at least on Nikkei. It was Nikkei Shimbun than this the announcement that there, this dialogue would finally be taking place. Now, why is there so little interest? Well, it's very difficult to set up an agenda when the other party, one of the parties to the dialogue is the Vice President of the United States. Not because he's stupid, not because he's there's anything wrong with Mr. Pence, but the problem is that the Vice President doesn't really have a team, and apparently is. And this is not an area, frankly, in which he is. He's more of a domestic policy person, if anything. And the Secretary of Commerce is coming along, and so is the Secretary of the Treasury, I believe. But the Secretary of Commerce is not, according to Japanese news reports, not taking part in the dialogue. Instead, he'll be in a sideshow with the MIDI minister. And in any case, the minister, the Department of Commerce is not really equipped to deal with much of the substance of the dialogue. It does not have the expertise to deal with the subject of the dialogue. Who does? Well, on the macroeconomics, I'll come to that later. The secretary, the Department of Treasury does, but on what it's called the bilateral arrangements, that looks like a job for the Trade Representative, who is still in the confirmation process. As for second and third tier appointments, they're very slow in coming. So the United States just does not have the apparatus in place to fill out the particulars of the dialogue that is about to ensue. So what are they going to do? And also, it was this the anticipation. I assure you, the North Korea celebrations and the failed missile launch is getting a lot more attention over the weekend than this dialogue. So there were other things happening. And besides, this is not on the economic front. You have to also keep in mind that this is not a priority issue this is a top priority issue for the United States. It's China, NAFTA, which actually means Mexico, and Japan in that order, I guess. We might not even, if Europe were ever in the position to negotiate the bilateral with the United States, that would probably take precedent. But it's not that nothing is going to come out of this meeting. According to news media reports, it's very credible if you match them against the joint statement, is that they're going to set up three working groups. One of them is going to tackle economic cooperation. The second is going to tackle macroeconomic collaboration. And third, and I think this is obviously the most important, the bilateral framework, a bilateral framework on trade and investment. By economic cooperation, apparently, it's It's what collaboration on building infrastructure and refurbishing and building out new infrastructure within the United States, which from the Japanese perspective really means high-speed rail. That's part of a... It dovetails very nicely with Trump... one of Trump's keynote initiatives, which is the infrastructure build-out. And also it is part of the Abenomics program, basically the export of what is called high-quality infrastructure. And that's really talking about our railroad system. And then there's cooperation energy, which is really developing and exporting unconventional fossil fuels, gas and oil, particularly gas, to Japan, which is also a break for the Trump administration. Well, not necessarily a break, but it accelerates a process that President Obama, the Obama administration, was only reluctantly embarking on. So this is really just dressing up public procurement and commercial transactions to make sure that there's something is going to come out. We'll have some positive, whatever else happens, we'll have some positive outcomes from the dialogue. I'll go into that in more detail later. And then the second, macroeconomic collaboration. This is what it says. I'm quoting from the joint statement, using the three-pronged approach of mutually reinforcing fiscal, monetary, and structural policies to strengthen domestic and global economic demand. That sounds nice, but how are we going to collaborate on fiscal policy? How are we going to collaborate on structural policy? These are domestic policies. Even the fiscal policy, even the EU members have trouble coordinating their fiscal policies. How can Japan use that? It's really about keeping Japan from the United States perspective, it's really about keeping Japan from driving down the yen. And the Japanese goal is to keep a free hand on monetary policy. And in an emergency, I think the Ministry of Finance does want to keep the option of direct intervention as an option. Okay, the bilateral framework on trade and investment. Now, this is where the goals are significant. There's a huge difference in goals, and they will have more practical, they will have more obvious practical consequences going forward, I believe. And that is here, the Japanese goal is basically. I think Prime Minister Abe's goal is to rope the United States back into TPP. Now, I used to think Prime Minister Abe was nuts for going this, and that I believe that, and this is something that I wrote in an op-ed the day after President Trump withdrew from as a party to the TPP negotiations, and that I thought he should go for the TPP minus TPP 11, if you will, and which he seemed to reject at the time, out of hand. I think he's trying to bring these two together again, and maybe he has what they call a puncher's chance of actually getting it done. Of course, the U.S. goal, the political goal, is to get a better bilateral deal than it got in TPPA. And I used to think, we're going to have to give something because, and I suspected that it would be some clause about currency manipulation. maybe couched in politer language, but something that the United States could point to. I'm not so sure now, and I'll get to that later. Okay, now, look at the easy ones. I think I already talked about the economic cooperation thing to some extent, but to add a few comments, it's really, you know, it doesn't matter what kind of high-speed railways in the United States, it could take the form of a public-private partnership. It could be a special purpose company backed by the states, backed by states. It could take a variety of forms. Whatever form it takes, there's going to be a bidding process. And the group of companies, the consortium, it will have to be a consortium. There's no other way to do this. The consortium that is deemed to have the best mix of performance, price, financing, and I think local production will get the nod in each and every case. And so it's really a commercial transaction. It's really, for the bidders, it's a commercial transaction. It's not like you can, it's not like the Prime Minister Abe can go to, the Republic of Trumpistan and cut a deal with the president and his family. That's not how it's going to work. So it's really putting a bilateral framework on this if you're not careful, it could be actually detrimental because you may not want a purely, like say Hitachi might not want to just have a purely Japanese consortium. Maybe JR Tokai might want to team up with, say Alstom, is that the French? Manufacturer. I don't know how this is going to play itself out, but it's something that there will be a government role to it, because you can be certain that the Japan Bank for International Cooperation, JBIC, and NEXI, the Nippon External Insurance Corporation, I believe that's its name is. You have to, NEXY. You'll have to Google that to about. They will provide the long-term financing that is allowed under OECD rules for this, and likewise, of course, the Germany, German, French, and Korean, and if they're allowed, the Chinese will have their own official export credit agencies. They'll be put into play. So it's like, it's really a commercial transaction. And if the Japanese corporations win out, are members of consortiums that win, then they will be touted as the positive outcomes of this collaboration. But it's really, that's really what it is. As for energy, same thing. It's really a commercial transaction. The Japanese utilities want to diversify their sources. They don't want to be solely reliant on the Middle East and Russia and who else? There's a lot of. I think Malaysia is still an exporter, although I don't know how long. So it's that, and the Americans definitely want to export to Japan because they're sure to get a better price on the overseas market than they can get at home. But that's really a commercial transaction. Again, here the Japanese authorities will provide long-term financing for the Japanese side of these businesses. But that's all it is. Macroeconomic collaboration. I think I already talked about that, but just as a data point, if you will, Japan. When I checked, I checked one of the few things that I really looked up carefully was the when did Japan last intervene? Well, in the directly intervene in the currency market, it was in November 2011. The yen at the time was around 78 yen per the dollar, very low. All the way down, Japan was intervening, and that was the last time Japan intervened. And all through 2012, that's basically where the yen remained. The 78-80 yen neighborhood, but never again did Japan intervene during that period. So I think you can take the Japanese authorities from that. You can take it. I think you can take the Japanese authorities the claims at face value that they do not intervene to deliberately drive down the yen or just or otherwise, but to reduce the volatility, if you will. I forget the exact phrase that they use, but that's basically what they claim they do, and it looks like that's what they have been doing. So barring another financial crisis, it's hard to see Japan directly intervening again. Because it's hard to see a dramatic rise in the value of the yen for the foreseeable future, because Japanese interest rates are going to remain low for the time being, and U.S. interest rates are going to go up over the at least over through the year, and. But it could flare up again. It could flare up again if the U.S. dollar keeps soaring and the U.S. dollar soars, and because Abe himself made a link between quantitative easing and the falling yen. He did it before he could put Mr. Kuroda in place, but he was criticized quite strongly for that, and he's completely backed away from that. But I think that still lingers because. As a practical matter, it is true. I mean, if low interest rates have an effect on the exchange rate, other things being equal. He was just saying, you could argue that he was stating the obvious, but that could become a contentious issue in the future. But it's probably not something that's really have to worry with Mr. Mnuchin in the Secretary of Treasury. But knock on wood. Okay, now here's the key issue in this dialogue, which is the bilateral framework on trade and investment. Now, why does Mr. Abe want TPP? Why did he commit the LDP to TPP despite the potential hit, which turned out not to be too large, too serious, because the opposition was so weak that by committing to TPP talks, it is a key element of Abenomics, and I was skeptical. I was skeptical about the government estimates that about the economic impact on Japanese GDP, but the World Bank has produced an even more. When the World Bank produced an even more optimistic, a significantly more optimistic outlook for Japan, I thought, well, maybe there really is some truth to the. To the efficacy of the agreement as as because of the effect that it does have through the through domestic structural, whatever structural domestic reform needs to be done, and probably more importantly, the structural reform that our trading partners, Vietnam and Malaysia, would be going through. There are two other goals that I have in mind, the first is I call depoliticizing international trade and investment relations, and that's another way of saying keep countries like the United States and more importantly China throwing its weight around. Now, free trade agreements are not a panacea. We've just seen that with the China South Korea FTA. Despite the free trade agreement, China has certainly been throwing its weight around against South Korea, as the U.S. The anti-missile system is being deployed in South Korea. And of course, the GATT never really protected us. Well, okay, it only partly protected us during the trade wars with the United States, when measures which we believe were illegal were imposed by the United States, and I think some shady self-restraint. Export self-restraint was conducted on the part of Japan. Voluntary self-restraints were, but it certainly helps. It certainly helps. And as platforms go global, it's really important that hegemons, global or regional, have a difficult time throwing their weight around. And then there's the non-economic aspect, which is basically keeping America engaged in Asia. America first, okay, but please Asia second. And as a foil for the regional hegemon, China. And so it's really not just about the economy. And why does Trump want a bilateral deal? Well, because, I think on a very visceral level, he wants to show that he can do better than Obama. And that was, to prove that he can cut a better deal. And cutting a better deal does play well into the, play well with his constituency. I don't think it's really, I won't go into that. Just forget about what I was just about to say, because it's not really that relevant here. It's just not just that he wants it. There are key actors to this, and there's a reason why TPP did have some serious distractors in the U.S. corporate world, and that certainly did not help prospects for TPP. And against the deal, I think the one prominent actor was the U.S. automakers, or is Chrysler really a U.S. automaker? There's an argument to be made against that. But the U.S. All we read in Japanese newspapers about the complaints that the Japanese market is not open, and the Japanese arguments against that. But that's not really the point. That's not really the point. You know, auto manufacturers, I mean, any serious auto manufacturer, they have their sourcing, manufacturing, marketing. All these platforms are global. These are global. So these parts come from Malaysia, and this like truck is assembled in Thailand. There's these, and I think one of the reasons President Trump has been quieter on about Mexico is that I think this talking with all these corporate heads that he's assembled around him, I think that has had a salutary effect on him, and he's realizing that it's not that simple. In the same, and so then what the U.S. So what's the gain for U.S. automakers? It's basically handicapping the Japanese, their competitors. Anything that is detrimental, anything that acts as a restraint, if only like whatever percentage, 10, something like more than 10% on SUVs from Japan, anything that that's this auto parts export coming from Japan, anything that has inconveniences, Japanese automakers in their global strategies is good for them, which is another way of saying they don't want a deal, period.
I'd like to open up for questions.
Oh, sorry. Okay. Pharmaceuticals. They want biologics data protection 12 years. Japan has 8. TPP, effectively 8. Beef and pork. Now, these are the people who should have wanted that, the TPP, and I'm surprised that they didn't. They did not lobby more harder. But over time, the Australian the reduced rates that Australia gets, and that is going to be progressively reduced, will become a problem for the United States, U.S. Beef and pork industry. And I think at some point they're going to want that deal. And they want that, copyright owners, they want that 70-year post-mortem works for them. 70-year after death, that's what they want, TPP would give them that. The Japanese alone it's difficult. Okay, and that's where the TPP-11 comes into play. When you have that when Japan has that, if Japan has that in place, it puts them in a better bargaining position. The fear was that the United States would link that to the security issues, but Secretary Mattis and Security Advisor McMaster, I think they've been pulling Trump more deeply and deeply into the center-right national security establishment. So and that mainstreaming, I think, sort of de-links security issue and trade issues, and that sort of diminishes the bargaining position of the Trump administration on the bilateral arrangement. I'm sorry, I'll cut it off. I'll leave it there.
Okay, thank you very much. We'll open up the floor to questions from the working press. Let me just ask you a quick question. You implied that it's not a coincidence that Japan has announced this weekend that it's willing to pursue a TPP of the 11. It's partly to give them leverage in this deal with the U.S.
I think that, I do believe that the timing was deliberate. It's really difficult to. It could not. Let me put it this way. It could not. It could not have come at a more serendipitous point in time.
Okay. Questions from the working press, please. First, yes, Patrick.
Hello, my name is Patrick Walter, Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung. I have two questions. One is concerning TPP 11. If you look at TPP 12, this was a network of concessions given by each country. If you take the big prize out, the big diamond, like the United States, how do you judge the opportunities, the chances to come to a result in TPP 11? Because the U.S. is not, the openness of the U.S. market is no longer part of the negotiations. And the second question is, if you look at these bilateral talks, if you compare that to the 80s, Japan was forced at that time to get into very industry-specific agreements, let's say automobile or other industries. Do you expect that at this time there will be similar outcomes, that you don't get to some kind of general agreements, but very industry-specific agreements?
The first question is, well, they're both very good questions, I believe. The first question really is about, well, will Malaysia and Thailand come along? Malaysia and Vietnam come along? Because the openness of Japan for their manufactured products is not really an issue. Japan does not have place very few tariffs on manufactured products. Those are concessions that we made long ago, and we're not going to back down on them, even though legally we could, but we're not going to do that. So what is there to gain from that, from this? Well, part of it is that they do have reasons to. I think the question boils down: is it enough to justify I don't know how the situation in Malaysia very well, but Vietnam is definitely trying to become a sort of the Vietnamese version of the authoritarian but very efficient market economy that China has. It does have the benefit of and so is that enough to is this 11 nation agreement enough to justify that? I think you really have to figure out. We'll find. I think. Let me put it this way: we'll find out. Maybe we'll have to cut back on some of those commitments, like 70 years on after death on copyright. Maybe we could leave that to a later occasion. Somebody else might come in that could make that, and that. It's useful to remember that was a uniquely American demand. Japan is still stuck on 50. But there's, on the other hand, if Vietnam is willing, wants to go ahead on its own, liberalize it through its own economic reform, which I believe they are sincere about, then it's really not the agreement. Let me put it this way: the agreement with Japan will not stand in the way of that. Malaysia is less of a, and I think I think we can probably forget about Thailand and the Philippines joining anytime soon. So it's really, but all the other nations, I think, wouldn't mind coming along. As for individual agreements, I don't see that happening. The United States does not, look, U.S. auto manufacturers are leaving Japan. It's a shrinking, fewer people are inclined to drive cars in an absolutely shrinking population. Nobody wants to commit their resources, their corporate resource to a place like that where there's already a bunch of competitors, well-established competitors. Besides, General Motors already had its chance. It gave up on Isuzu, and Isuzu still exists. Ford gave up on Mazda. Mazda still exists. So and nobody talks about that. I don't see any area in which now that everything is every industry take the information communication technology industry as well. You know, there's this buying and selling left and right across borders. The whole corporations divisions are just changing hands across borders willy nilly. So it's really not that kind of an environment anymore. So I don't think that's an outcome. If anything, there will be no. It's just a series of dialogues that will continue forever. That's possible. But if there's no concrete deal, then I think what we'll end up with really no real deal.
Süddeutsche Zeitung, Neidhardt. Two questions. First, there was quite a few pro-free trade people who were against TPP because of all these judicial things, like corporations could sue governments, and governments would actually lose more than trade sovereignty. So do you think Japan would stick to these, or if Japan would get rid of these non-trade issues, probably there would be much less resistance against TPP. And my second question is, you said appropriately that Mr. Pence is probably not the right person to negotiate trade deals. Mr. Aso has been, of course he's Minister of Finance, but he's been very quiet and we don't see much of Mr. Aso. Do you think, how much power does Mr. Aso have in this sense? Or is, basically, is this a one-person government as well?
Well, first of all, I don't think those were the exact words that I used to describe Vice President Spence. I put more emphasis on the lack of the human resources available for this, and I specifically mentioned the USTR, Treasury, and Commerce for the kind of the commercially oriented deals. So, and that the people are not in place there. I don't think there's any there's. I don't think concern is about sovereignty. The sovereignty issue has been raised in Japan. It's just, I think it's a little less too esoteric, if you will, for the opposition parties to focus on, and it's. It's sovereignty has always been a big issue with the United States. That's why it did not join the, it did not become a party to the UN Convention on the Law of the Seas. That is why it never became a party to, we can go back to the League of Nations. It's something that the Kyoto Protocol. There's a myriad of examples where. So there's definitely a very strong concern from the U.S. side, which is in some ways I think it's understandable. I mean, no hegemon wants constraints on its own powers, although sometimes they would actually benefit from such constraints. I mean, if somebody had veto power over the decision to invade Iraq, for example, mm-hmm. although you could argue that the UN system failed there, but leaving that aside, so it's not, at least with Japan, it's not a concern, but I think it all depends on if we get some kind of message from the U.S. side. I think, you know, it from a populist point of view, that's not good. But from the perspective of U.S. corporations, not just U.S. corporations, but global corporations, it's something nice to have in hand, even if an occasion to exercise that never occurs against the members of TPP. But it's something that probably will be looked into in whatever TPP 11 talks, because there's several sides to it. Mr. Aso, you know, I think he's basically from what I've seen, and I do know him somewhat because I was with the Economic Planning Agency when he first became a cabinet minister as the head of the agency, and I think people remember him, and I don't think he's changed. Is that he's basically an agreeable person who's willing to front the organization that he's heading. So and at the end of the day, he's willing to, but he's not going to, but he's not a person that will resign on principle because the desires of that organization is not accepted by the full cabinet. I think that's the impression that I have from seeing him work with the Ministry of Finance over the years. And no way would I use the word sock puppet for describe him. But so this is not, and remember that this is going to be broken down into, if newspaper reports are correct, three working groups. The unconventional gas, the export stuff, that could go under the purview of Mr. Ishida or perhaps even Mr. Seko, that's the Ministry of Economy, Trade, and Industry. But it would be something for Mr. Ishida to deal with. And I'm not quite sure where the bilateral arrangement will fit in. Will Mr. Ishida be charged with it? He should be in charge of TPP 11. The other one will the other one will be the macroeconomic stuff. That's going to be taken care of by the Ministry of Finance, which conveniently happens to be headed by the head of this a Japanese delegation in these dialogues. So I think there's not going to be much of a problem unless Japan somehow decides that it wants to directly intervene in the currency market, or at some point in the not too near future, the Japanese monetary policy becomes an issue as U.S. interest rates go up.
Just picking up on that very briefly, you said that it's about keeping Japan from driving down the yen. That was the phrase you used. I mean, Japan already is party to the G20 agreement on the currencies, so what more could they put into this agreement, this bilateral agreement, that would supplement what's already in the G20 agreement?
I don't know. Maybe they could put in a bilateral, it could be a bilateral consultation arrangement. That something that looks, just throwing it out there, something that looks more under the control of the United States. Something that where you can bring direct pressure on. And perhaps if there can be, if the United, for example, if the United States, you're just tossing out an idea here, if the United States could make a prima facie case that the Japanese monetary policy is keeping the yen at a rate that is significantly below what the rates, the historical relationship between interest rates, exchange rates, and inflation rates are.
Okay, next question. Sorry, are you working press? Sure, go ahead.
Here's Ishiyama from AFP. Thank you very much for your time and talks. Just two quick questions. Is that your view that, just to clarify, is that your view that this meeting or this visit by Mike Pence and his meeting with the Tarasso, do you find it that it has more symbolic meaning rather than the actual substantive meeting, or that something that will have policy implications? And question number two, do you think that the Abe administration or the LDP will try to bring the United States back to the TPP forum, maybe later in the Trump administration or possibly the next during the next administration? Thank you.
I think that is definitely the intent of the Abe administration to bring the Trump administration around on TPP. I don't know. It all turns on whether he can sell it to his base. And I think one of the things that I think there should be more taken more notice of is that people look at all his flip-flopping, and it really doesn't appear to have hurt him with his base. And now we're reading articles that the U.S. economy is so hot that the companies are having difficulty hiring in the Rust Belt. Is that anecdotal? Perhaps. But what we're seeing is that the support for much of the support for President Trump as a candidate and as a president is visceral, not necessarily based on a rational calculation of the policies that he set out. And of course, there's always the Fox News and other conservative media cloud that that conveniently spins everything that the Trump administration will do. As long as he does not really go overboard on certain, I would call, really visceral issues, and so I think he could change his mind if he does so, I'm sure that the other 11 will find way, will look very carefully for ways to enable President Trump to claim victory. Excuse me, what was your first? I'm sorry. I forgot. Your first question was?
The first question is the upcoming meeting with the...
Yes. No, I think it's not, you know, let me put it this way. I don't think that it will end up in, changes in the, on the commercially oriented deals, I don't think it's going to make a difference. It's not going to make a difference. On the macroeconomics, this dialogue is going to be something that will always something that the Japanese side will always have to keep in mind when in how it manages the exchange rates, or rather, how it manages its foreign reserves, if you will, because that's what you use to intervene, and also it's something to keep a careful eye on when managing monetary policy, whether or not Mr. Kuroda is around for a second term. I think the in a way, its very existence serves a purpose for the United States, I believe. The third one is, frankly, I'm not sure where this is going to end up. I don't think that it's going to end up, well, I used to think that it was going to end up in a bilateral deal. Bilateral free trade agreement is something added for just to make President Trump happy. Now that was my assessment around January, maybe even February. Not now. I think the likelihood of a bilateral free trade agreement has gone down significantly. It's still possible. I wouldn't say that one or the other is likely. It's now, I think, very much up in the air. Now that the linkage between the security issue is very much, it's greatly diminished.
Why is the linkage with the security issue greatly diminished? Perhaps I've missed the point, but why is that?
Well, I think people really focused on Mr. Flynn's reassurance that the nuclear umbrella is in place. I think more attention should be paid to Secretary Mattis's assertion that Japan is I forget his words, but basically he's telling Mr. Trump and others that saying publicly that Japan is pulling its weight. That those were not the words he used. I think he said something more like this is a model example or whatever, something like that. He likes the arrangement. What does he like? That Japan pays like half of the costs to keep them here, keep troops here. Well, that helps, but those troops, part of it's you know, for example, if you the United States could actually use Yokota base to hit North Korea. Nuclear weapons, if it so desires, or at least that's my reading of the security treaty and the status agreement, or whatever it's called. It's not a name that comes off the top of my head, but you can. It's easy to look it up. You have this is Japan is the ultimate unsinkable fortress. Granted, it does not have. There are no nuclear weapons here, but they have all these submarines and stuff for that. They no longer even have nuclear weapons on their aircraft carriers, so that's not really necessary. Otherwise, the Seventh Fleet, and of course, if Carl Vinson decides to stop over Yokosuka or Sasebo, fine. So it's a very, very convenient and very, very stable military asset for the United States, which means, and this is something that people should talk more about in Japan, and that we are also, it makes them a military target. Now, here's the thing. If North Korea decides to go on an all-out war against South Korea, it's gonna bombard Seoul. If it wants to make a point without really touching off a war, then it's going to do some kind of a cross-border attack that does not hit critical targets in South Korea. Something across the border. A few mortars and maybe a couple of Scud rockets or whatever. That's what I think. But if Kim Jong Un decides to go out in blazes, in a blaze of glory, if you will, and I don't think he's that kind of person. But it's just hypothetically, because you never should rule out something that the law of physics allows. Remember, there are a lot of Japanese Imperial Army officials who are willing to go down in blazes and to take Japan down with it. So you never know. But in that case, there are like how many U.S. troops in South Korea? What kind of military assets does the United States have in South Korea? The closest U.S. military assets are in Japan. That's something that I think we should always keep in mind, because I think that's part of the calculations that goes into the statements made by Mr. Mattis. Now, of course, it's not something, obviously, the Abe administration, it's not something that the Abe administration would want to talk about, because if you ever said anything like that, if the current administration ever touched on anything like that, I mean, all bets are off for the rest of this Diet session, except maybe the act to allow the emperor to abdicate. That's going to get passed, but all other bets are going to be off, because it's the Japanese media, the Japanese opposition will be really, well, they will really have something to talk about.
Okay, well, are you prepared to take just one final question?
Yes, sorry. Last question.
Siegfried Knittel, freelancer from Germany. I read some news that some American official, I don't know, was it Mr. Mattis, or who said, oh, there is a warm relationship between Xi Jinping and President Trump. So there are some people, perhaps in the Japanese government, thinking about this good relation could be dangerous for Japan. Perhaps something like 1972 could happen again when Nixon went to China. So I think, you know, in a traditional, prior war time, there was every time that the U.S. thought about who should be the main ally or a main close country, Japan or China. Could this situation happen again? You know, I think Mr. Trump is not a man who can trust, you know. But do you think it's an opportunity or a possibility?
I think it's useful to remember what happened when President Nixon made peace with Mao Zedong. Japan was next in line. Many Japanese politicians were, particularly in the LDP, were deeply committed to Taiwan, emotionally committed to Taiwan. And it has to do with how the war ended, how the Kuomintang acted at the end of the war, Chiang Kai-shek at the end of the war. Japan just fairly quickly followed suit, as did the rest of the world. And all was at peace. And it really was a good thing for the world. Now, Japan does not want the United States and China to go to war. It does not even want an antagonistic relationship with China. And things are very different. And really, things are very different because there's so many economic interests that Japan and China share now. In a way similar to how China and U.S. share economic interests. Anything that Taiwan may have something to worry about, because its de facto sovereignty may be further threatened. Although so I think the Prime Minister Abe would act. So it's not really, it's no longer a matter of choosing this over that. It's a matter of having creating a space where there is the economic relationships are run as unfettered as possible under rule of law, and there is a minimal political tension to obstruct that free flow of commerce. So I think Mr. Abe would act. Mr. Abe and most people in the LDP would welcome a good relationship there. Partly because, well, for example, China would have to cut back on its cyber activities that it's conducting, which the U.S. appears to have subsided significantly. The U.S. has a lot of complaints about the bilateral relationship with China, and I think Japan will actually benefit from whatever administrative and legal improvements that the United States is able to wrangle out of China. And of course, China could keep a lid on North Korea's nuclear program, then all the better.
Okay, unfortunately, we do need to wrap up there. Thank you very much, Okumura-san, for coming along and briefing us. We appreciate it. I certainly found it most interesting. To encourage you to come back again, that is a one-year honorary membership of the club.
Thank you very much. It is my pleasure.